Namaskaram and good evening, everyone. Welcome to the second edition of Kerala Architecture Festival, Spaces, a festival of culture, politics, and design. I, architect Ashish M., associate professor at DC School of Architecture and Design, Vagaman, will be co-hosting this event. An event promoted by DC Kerakamuri Foundation and DC School of Architecture and Design, Vagaman and Trivandrum campuses. DC Kerakamuri Foundation and DC Books is behind one of the largest, India's largest literature events, Kerala Literature Festival. The topic for today is Calicut, the city and its past. The distinguished speakers for the evening are Captain Ramesh Babu and Dr. V.V. Haridas. Kozhikode, also known as Calicut, where the great Portuguese explorer Vasco da Gama introduced trade routes between Europe and Malabar. Both the speakers for the evening has carried out immense research and documentation on the history and heritage of Kozhikode. Captain Ramesh Babu, being a travel and a history enthusiast, actively following Calicut's heritage, helping and supporting all in need. He has also narrated through his book, Calicut Heritage Trials, The History of Calicut. Dr. V.V. Haridas has a vivid knowledge on early Indian history with predominant insight on pre-modern Kerala history and its culture as HOD, Department of History in Calicut University. We appreciate all present to please send in their questions into the panel board. Without further delay, let's welcome both the speakers to exchange and express views on Calicut, the city and its past. I invite Captain Ramesh Babu to start the conversation with Dr. V.V. Haridas. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ashish, for the generous introduction. We have Dr. Haridas, who is a hardcore historian with a number of books on Calicut and the rest of India's history, who is also an academician teaching in the Calicut University. And I am there. I'm just a heritage enthusiast with just one book to my credit and having and conducted a number of heritage walks in the city. So we hope we are able to blend our backgrounds together and give you a good recipe on the city, which will highlight its history, heritage, and how it was planned to become a port city and also the capital city of one of the longest ruling dynasties in India's history. So with that, we will start. You know, all of us are aware that right from antiquity, the monsoon winds have brought in merchants to the west coast of India. And some of the earliest records, like the Periplus of the Erythraean Sea, actually locate major port cities of the first century AD. However, Calicut does not figure in the map that is given by the Erythras of the Periplean Sea. Now, how did Calicut emerge then? That story has a background, because everybody who had an access to the sea became a very wealthy ruler or a king or a feudal lord, whatever you called him at that time. There was this particular feudal lord called the Eradi, who was kind of landlocked. He did not have a waterfront. So he had to have a waterfront to become a very, very powerful ruler. Now, how did the Eradi, who traditionally was probably a cattle grazing person, a community of cattle grazers, landlocked in the eastern part of what we now call as the Calicut, that cityscape, eastern part of the Calicut airport actually. How did he emerge to become the Samudri? So the beginnings of that story are given in Keralolpathi, which actually is a mix of fact and folklore that showcases emergence of Kerala. So To give us a narrative on that story, I would now invite Dr. Haridas, the historian. Come on, sir.
Thank you, Ramesh sir. It's very interesting story, as you said, because the Calicut, which doesn't have a long history of like other ports mentioned in the Periplus of the Erythraean Sea, there is no mention of Calicut at all in that narrative of first century of Common Era. So how Calicut emerged and when it emerged is a very interesting story. I would like to say Calicut as port as well as capital as a medieval city. It's in the 12th, 13th century we can hear about Calicut. It's a port city, a harbor, which later developed into a capital city, and it became a center of politics. And when Vasco da Gama came, actually, we can see Calicut entering the world history, international history. So the story is very interesting because we have evidence only in tradition, as you said, rightly pointed out. In Keralolpathy, the tradition, we have evidence or at least some bits of evidence in Keralolpathy, where the earlier Nadu Udayavar, Eranad Udayavar or Eralanad Udayavar emerging as a ruler, like a sort of king, Zamorin. So very interesting story in Keralolpathy. It narrates the story with certain causation. Actually, it's a historical narrative they are taking or they are making. But we can see that more or less it goes like a legend. And we have some other evidences, better evidences in inscriptional evidences, epigraphical evidences, where we find out this Ernad Udayavar, as you pointed out, Yediripu is a place from where this Zamorin came to Calicut, captured Calicut, then settled there, developed his own kingdom. So Yediripu is actually at present in the Malappuram district. It's near Kondoti, where we have still a village called Yediripu. A panchayat named Yediripu is there near Kondoti. So from this Yediripu, which is actually in and around this Yediripu, is the Eranad or Eralanad of the Chera period, which is actually a landlocked territory. Nadus under Chera kingdom, we have so many Nadus, at least 16 to 18 Nadus are named under Cheras. One is Eralanad, and it is from this landlocked territory the Yediripu Swarupam emerged. So I may tell about this story, interesting story, which is narrated in the Keralolpathy tradition. It's like this. That is, hearing the last Perumal, last Chera Perumal, he is called Cheraman Perumal. He had partitioned his kingdom, Cheradam. And he was going to embraced Islam, and he is going to Mecca. So when these two Eradi brothers, Manichan and Vikiran, some says it is nephew and uncle also. So one is called Pundurakon. So when they heard about this Islam, this sale of Cheraman Perumal to Mecca, they visited him. And actually they had a relation earlier also. They helped this Cheraman Perumal in his battle, which was fought earlier against Krishna Devarayar. So the Perumal told them that he had already given his kingdom to his followers, his relatives, and only a small territory called Chullikkad and Kokkozhikkod is remaining with him. So they were ready to accept this small territory, a very small region. And Cheraman gave this territory, this tract of land. Along with that, we can see that in the story it mentions he gave along with that the Qadi, the Muslim Qadi, along with other Muhammadans, other Muslims, and the right of navigation to Mecca. That means West Asian trade or Arabian trade, and he gave his sword, his own sword, Perumal's sword was given to this these Eradi brothers, and he gave him an injunction, actually a blessing, that is, you can kill and annex, to die, kill and annex, chattum konnum kedakkuka, that is the blessing given, and you have to rule as Nediviruppu Swarupam, that is the story. Then they began to capture the various regions. This story actually is a significant, even though it is a story, it is a significant one that also I'll just mention, and I will move on to you. That is, so the story actually preserves a memory in which the feudatory chiefs of Eranadu or the Eralanadu Udayavar emerged as the Samorin, as independent rulers of Kozhikode, and it highlights the cause for their success, that is the Arabian trade, which is very important for the Zamorin's emergence, the emergence of Calicut. So let us now move on to other aspects.
Yeah, so the historian has actually told us the story. Now, wielding that sword which the Perumal or the emperor had given to the Eradi cousins or the Eradi uncle and nephew, whatever was the combination, they became known as the Manavikramans. The two combinations came to be called as Manavikramans. So now, wielding the sword, which are the royal diktats, that you may kill, die and annex, they came and, you know, set up their camp in this Chullikad or this thorny bush marshland or Kokkozhikode, a small patch of land where if the cock actually, you know, made its noise, it would be heard across the region. From there, they started. And let me tell you, to establish their foothold in that area, they had to lay siege on the ruling king of that place for 48 long years. And they broke that siege thanks to an inside help from the wife of that king, and finally established their rule and slowly developed that marshy, thorny land into a full-fledged kingdom. It also coincidentally happened that the Musiris port, which was till then the most flourishing port, was silting up, and there were a lot of other issues. For example, the other communities, trading communities, had come over there, and they were attempting to chase away this Muslim traders, who incidentally were coming all the way from East Africa, the Gulf of Hormuz, Persia, and all these countries. Now, the so-called Arab traders or the Muslim traders also were looking for a new port. And as Dr. Haridas said, the emperor, the departing emperor, connected up these two people, one looking to set up a kingdom along the sea coast, the other looking to set up a port along the sea coast. So the two of them came together to develop Calicut into a world-class port. Now, to administer that port city, the Zamorin actually set up a beautiful city plan. The town planning was very, very meticulously done. The SM Street, the Sweetmeat Street, which is these days in the news because the traders there are having a problem of government-imposed restrictions to open their shops. That SM Street, which is so very popular a locality, it is actually a heritage locality in Calicut, was the north-south axis of the Zamorin's Calicut fort. It was decided as per the Vastu principles, and the Zamorin had all the needed establishments set up inside a fort, of which the north-south axis was the SM Street. The Zamorin's official residence, the Samudri Koilagam. Incidentally, we keep talking about Zamorin Samudri. This word comes from Samudradishan. He emerged as the lord of the seas, the Samudradishan, and then came to be called as the Samudri. Now, the Samudri's official residence, or the Samudri Kovilagam, occupied the place of most important, significance inside this court, inside this fort complex. And when Vasco da Gama visits Calicut and enters and meets the Zamorin, Vasco da Gama actually gets surprised with the you know, with the splendor of this fort and the splendor of the royal residence. I will now invite Dr. Haridas to talk a little about what Vasco da Gama saw there.
Yeah, it's very interesting. Actually, we have so many references in the foreign accounts with regard to the fort palace of Zamorin. One is the account of Vasco da Gama's visit. It is an anonymous author who wrote down the Vasco da Gama's visit in 1498. And he actually moved from Kapad to Calicut. That description, that vivid description about the palace is like this. I may quote, this is the account of that anonymous author. Though only constructed of earth, the palace was very extensive and seemed a handsome structure, having great numbers of trees interspersed among the different buildings with pleasant gardens. On passing the last gate, the general and his attendants went along with the noblemen into a great hall surrounded with seats of timber raised in rows above one another, like our theatres, the floor being covered by a carpet of green velvet and walls hung with silk of various colors. This is the description we are getting from that account. And even other travelers like Varthema, an Italian traveler of 16th century, also gives an elaborate description of the palace of the Zamorin. He says that the palace of the king is about a mile in circumference. That is the walls are very low, but with very beautiful divisions of wood with the devils carved in relief. And the floor of the house is all adorned with cow dung. That is the account given by Varthema. Another account we have on this is that of an Italian, Pietro Della Valle. He also make a rough and unmeasured ground plan of the Zamorin's palace and place where the Zamorin gave them audience. Actually, he made a sketch of this palace in his account. And here also, Della Valle also, but not much impressed. As an Italian, he may have seen so many edifices. So he says, I will conclude with that, the edifice in comparison of ours was of little consideration. But according to their mode, that means our mode, the Indian people's mode, both for greatness and appearance capable of a royal family. That is the account he makes about the palace of the Zamorin. So that is the way, that is the way in which the Koviligam or the palace was seen by the foreigners. With their accounts, it's clear that they are thinking Calicut, its constructions, as one of the major constructions. Since they have visited so many places, even with such vast experience, they make a comment that it is a big one, it's a beautiful one, is very remarkable in medieval context. Another thing is that even Ibn Battuta, in the 14th century, he also says that it is one of the most beautiful cities in the world, just like Alexandria, a comparison he has made. So these references, and even our own Unnunili Sandesham makes a reference, cross reference to our Kollam, Koilon. Calicut is a beautiful city like Kollam, or more than Kollam is the Kozhikodum Punaradhinu Kollavum Punaradhinado Tulyamalla, that like that. So it's more beautiful than Kollam is the reference made in Unnunili Sandesham, a 14th century Malayalam work or Manipravala work. So that's the way the layout of the Koviligam or the palace is made. So we will move into other aspects of the city.
Yeah, so while you know, the Italian who was used to the splendor of Rome might not have found it as impressive as Rome, all the other travelers and the local chroniclers found the Calicut Royal Palace to be a majestic palace. So did the Chinese, Now, while there is enough records on Arab traders coming to Calicut, there is not very much available on Chinese travels to Calicut. The Zamorin had a direct link with the Chinese emperor and of the Ming dynasty. And whenever there was a coronation of a new Zamorin, the Ming emperor used to send gifts and presents. So much so that the most celebrated Chinese admiral, Admiral Zheng He, made 7 trips to Calicut. And it is believed that, he died off and he's buried off Calicut. Going ahead with the town plan of Calicut, a little detached from this royal palace or the official palace was the palayam or the cantonment. And along between the fort wall and the palayam cantonment was the kalari, which was the martial arts school. Further down was the place of worship, the Thali temple. It is believed that, when the Zamorin emerged as a king, the Thaliyadiris, the Tamil, the Brahmins who were administering the Thali temple refused to give in, and the Zamorin had to actually fight his way through and take over the temple. The royal sword that Dr. Haridas referred to earlier was later broken into smithereens by the Dutch in a battle, but whatever was remaining was collected, re-smelted, and that royal sword, which was gifted to him by the Chairman Perumal, probably in the 12th century AD, is still preserved in the Thali temple. So the Thali temple was actually a place of worship. It was also a place of power for the Zamorin. And it is around the Thali temple that he built his family's palaces, the Kovilagams, including the Pudhiya Kovilagam, the Padinyare Kovilagam, the Kezhakke Kovilagam. Pudhiya Kovilagam means the new palace. Kezhakke Kovilagam means the Eastern Palace, Padinyare Kovilagam means the Western Palace, and also the Ambadi Kovilagam, the Matriarch's Palace, the Royal Matriarch, the Zamorin's Matriarch Palace was built just behind the Thali Temple. I would request Dr. Haridas to talk a little about the Ambadi Kovilagam. Who was the Ambadi Kovilagam? What respects did Zamorin pay to her? And, what was her significance?
Yes, thank you. This Ambadi Kovilagam is the, as you rightly point out, is the senior lady of this royal house. Zamorin's royal house resides there, the Ambadi Kovilagam Thamburati. She is the senior most lady, and Zamorin visits even this lady and calls her as Amma, mother. Irrespective of their relation, he used to call her as mother, maybe his sister, but he used to call Ambadi Kovilagam Thamburati, that means the senior most lady, as mother. And this Ambadi Kovilagam is within this complex of palace, or within the fortification of Calicut. And we have evidence of Zamorin visiting this Ambadi Kovilagam Thamburati in the 17th century. He asked, that means she asked Zamorin to come and visit, since he was staying in Ponnani, at Ponnani he was. So requested Zamorin to come and meet her. So he desired, and the entire procession, royal procession from Ponnani to Calicut, is narrated in the Palace Chronicle. So where we get all the details how he is coming. So he moves from Ponnani. Each and every this one is given. It took about 8 days from Ponnani to Calicut. Actually, it will not take that much time, but for the royal procession, it took 8 days. So he reached on 8th day only at Calicut. So he crosses Kallai, the river Kallai. Then there he was actually received by all the prominent persons of Calicut, including the Khasi, including the Koya, Kozhikode Koya, and other prominent persons, traders and other royal functionaries. And he moved to the palace complex, and it's outside the fortification. He get down from the litter. Actually, he is coming in the palanquin, and he get down there. Then on foot, actually, he moves to Ambadi Kovilagam. He met Ambadi Kovilagam Thampurati and get the wishes of Ambadi Kovilagam Thampurati, the senior most princess. And we have evidence of Ambadi Kovilagam Thampurati in other documents as well. She is getting a due when coins are minted. The coins are minted. She is given a due. That means these much panams are given to Ambadi Kovilagam Thampurati. Then there are Nediyurippil Valiya Thampurati, Nediyurippil Cheriya Thampurati is also there. Three positions are given to these senior most ladies. And it's actually maternal line. Thavazhi is the ruling dynasty. As you mentioned, Pudhiya Kovilagam, Kizhakke Kovilagam and Padinjare Kovilagam. These are the three joint families or Thavazhis which existed in Calicut, and it is the senior most person, male, in these families become the Zamorin. So the story is very, very interesting. Actually, Zamorin's wife doesn't have much to in the rule of the kingdom, even though she is also a part of this rule. So let us move it to the city structure.
The significance of the matrilineal system and you know how important the Ambadi Kovilagam was. That senior lady could be much younger to the Zamorin himself, but still he called her Amma and paid the respects. And it is only after visiting her that he went to the Thali temple. And there is a gateway, the western gateway of the Thali temple allows entry even today only for the Zamorin's family, which continues. The three Kovilagams that Dr. Haridas alluded to, their successors still, have been given the titular role of the Zamorin. Today, the Zamorin of Calicut is a 94-year-old gentleman. He has got his, princes in waiting who are all from the other, Kovilagams. The Thali temple itself was also the seat of the Revadi Patratanam, which I think we should not be digressing into that, but it was a competition of grammar scholarship, which actually was much, much more rigorous than what happened in Ujjain. So the Thali temple was a power center. Now, going further into the plan of the city, within the complex itself, as I said, there was a palayam adjacent to the fort complex, then there was the kalari. Within the complex itself or around that, there were all the necessary establishments which were required to run a very successful administration. For example, they had a kammattam or a mint. They had an akkashala. They had an agrashala. They had a community dining hall. They had numerous temples. They had a record. They had an archive. In fact, Zamorin at any point of time would have something like 12 to 13 record keepers. So all these records were preserved. And now, we will talk a little bit about the kammattam. I'm sure Dr. Haridas will be able to give us a little bit about the kammattam, because the Zamorin was one of those very few rulers in India who was allowed to mint his own coins. So I will now invite Dr. Haridas to talk a bit about the kammattam and the minting system that they had.
First, I will actually, I forgot to tell about Thali temple. Thali temple is very, very significant one. And we have reference in the Palace Chronicle about the Thali temple complex. Actually, it has so many sub shrines. Even though it's a Shiva temple, so many sub shrines found within the complex. And one is Vishnu's Trivikramapuram temple. That's why I just want to mention it. Trivikramapuram temple is the Vishnu temple. It existed within this Thali complex. And Trivikramapuram, it's actually giving the divinity status to the king. Manavikrama, his puram. It also means Trivikramas, Vishnu's city. So that's by that indenter, you can simply equate the king with the god Vishnu. This is done in almost all the cases. Chola king Rajarajeshwara is done like that. So like that, here also, even though it's a small kingdom, here also we have an attempt to divinize the king. That's what I want to tell about the Talit temple. And coming to the Kamatam, the mint, we have evidence of this mint because we have reference in the Granthavari about this mint. We have reference in the foreign accounts that Pirard of Laval, a French traveler of 17th century, he speaks about a large building near the market where this panams or the coins are minted. And Manavikrama Achari, actually Manavikrama Perumthattan, actually he is a goldsmith. So the Manavikrama Perumthattan mint these coins. So it has, the coin has the symbol. One side is pagoda, another side is the head of the king. But usually what we got is actually symbols and the certain shankh or kunch and other symbols on Dobbo's side. This is the what the panams is. And we have another, that is taram, another coin. Not only the gold coin, gold, it is gold coin, the panam. Another is taram, which is actually a copper coin, which is 1/16 of the panam. That is also minted. So these, and another thing is that, interesting thing is that Barbosa says that minting coin is a royal prerogative. You cannot mint coins like this, particularly gold coin and coins of high value. You cannot mint. Only the royal or the sovereignty can make the mint. Like that, the tiled roofs also. You cannot make the tiled roof. Only the temples or the royal palaces or the royal buildings will have the tiled roofs. So the privilege of minting coin itself is a royal prerogative, which the Zamorin has done. And it is in the Calicut, we can see this mint. So yeah, we'll move to the other
sectors. Yeah, he also had people of lesser skills. For example, he had a royal barber, he had a royal tailor. But, you know, we will now go into the main features. Water was aplenty in this complex. You know, the chroniclers of Gama talks about water fountains, streams and all that. A tank which was built in the 12th century, the Mananjara, is still there and it still supplies fresh water to the Calicut city. So that was a kind of, you know, town planning that was done. He had other tanks and other streams and other fountains inside his complex. The Zamorin actually dug a number of tanks. There were, I think, about 17 or 19 of them, including some which were specifically meant for bathing elephants. Now, we will now go a little to the west because that is where the port was. And the Zamorin laid out a very, very well-planned port with its warehouses, with its taxation offices, and also settlements. You know, he actually allotted land for this traders, and his primary traders were Arab traders, and they came in. You know, they used to come, their ships used to berth, and then, you know, spices used to be loaded and sent back. But they followed a cycle, actually. One of the captains brought the ship, and then another captain took the ship away. So this captain stayed on to collect enough spices and other goods. So he had a considerably long stay in Calicut, maybe for a couple of years, till the time he got replaced. So the Zamorin allowed him to marry into Nair, you know, families of Calicut, and a very unique settlement emerged in Calicut, which was a settlement of Arab traders marrying into local Hindu aristocratic families. That is the Kutijara settlement. The Kutijara settlement continues to survive. It has got residences in the Naligat or Ettugat form, which is a traditional Nair, you know, Menon residential structure. And it has got a lot of other unique traditions, including the matrilineal system, which is not really followed in many of the other Islamic communities. It has got mosques, and these mosques follow temple architecture, you know, because they were built by temple artisans for these Arab traders. So I would now request Dr. Haridas to talk about, you know, the life inside the Kutichira households, and also a stone tablet which is found in the Muchundi Mosque, which is in Vattayaduthu or Kolayaduthu, and the bilingual stone tablet. So I would request Dr. Haridas to talk a little about the Kutichira settlement and its mosque, and especially this tablet.
Yes. That Muchundi mosque inscription is, as you said, is one of the earliest document of Zamorin. Since he was having relation with Arabs, and as you said, rightly pointed out, the Arabs, the Arab traders had the matrimonial relation with the native ladies, and that is how Mapilas, the native Muslims, emerged in Calicut, and they became the backbone of Zamorin's trade and seafaring activities. So he has given all the benefits to these Muslims, and that's how in the coastal area Muslims began to make their own settlements, and of course their own worshipping place, mosque also built in various places. One of the earliest Mishkal mosque is like this. Then another is Muchundi Mosque, from where we got evidence of a 13th century inscription, where actually Zamorin, his name is mentioned as Pundurakon. Pundurakon is giving a grant to the mosque. That is, some certain lands are given, granted, for the expenses of the officials in the mosque. So in order to meet the expense of the mosque, he is actually making a grant which we have already seen in the Chera period. Also, we can see to the Syrian Christians, to the Jews, the Kerala kings made such grants. So it is here, it is the case of giving it to the Arabs and to the Muslims. And it is a bilingual, as you mentioned rightly, it's a bilingual inscription in Malayalam, Old Malayalam and Arabic, and it's a bi-scriptural as well. Yes. Vattayaduthu and Arabic was used. So you can see that Arabic was used in this stone tablet. It's embossed as well. It's another interesting thing is that usually we engrave on stone tablets. The inscriptions are usually engraved, but here it is embossed. So the effort they took in to write this inscription is also very, very significant. And here we have Arabic prayers, Arabic signatures. So a long list of witnesses, they are present there, and they make their own signature. So that is the 13th century inscription. And about Pundurakon also, I have to tell something, because Pundurakon is a title Zamorin uses from the early period. From the beginning, he uses this title Pundurakon, and later in the Granthavari, he uses it. But sometimes between 15th to 16th century, 17th century, we are not hearing much about Pundurakon in the official documents. But in the 18th century, again, we hear about Pundurakon. And I have a wonderful hypothesis regarding this one. One thing is that Pundurakon itself is a local, localized term of Bandarkon. Bandar is actually in Arabic the harbor. So it's Zamorin was regarded as Bandarkon by the Arabs, because he is the king of the port, king of the harbor, that is Calicut. So they called him as Bandarkon, Kon, the Malayalam for Raja. So this Bandarkon later converted as Pundurakon, because we have another reference, Shabandar Koya. It is Shabandar, which became Samandra Koya and Sabandra Koya. So the natives making changes in the Arabic terms and localizing it. So Bandarkon may be later changed into Pundurakon, and that title was used earlier. But what happened when his power expanded to various parts of Malabar, and he is now not a ruler of port. So Pundurakon became not an attractive title. So for that reason, they did not use this title for some time, and they instead used Kunnalakon. That means the ruler of Malayalam or ruler of Kerala. That is more interesting for them. But in the later part, what happened was he already established his power. So he is now a Malabar ruler. So he thought that using Pundurakoni in this 18th century is not a problem. Because of its heritage value, he should have again used this Pundurakoni. And his order is called Pundurakon Theet. Royal Order of Zamorin is called Pundurakon Theet. That is my hypothesis. But we can consider that it may be the reason why it was not used for some period. So coming back to the Arab traders, Arab Muslim trade, Sanjay Subramanian, the great scholar, already called Zamorin as trade protector monarch. Because of the trade, Arab trade, and as you said, the Chinese trade, Zamorin emerged as a very, very powerful ruler. So trade is one of the significant part of Zamorin's revenue, which created this Calicut port as well as Calicut kingdom. So urban space actually developed with this trade, the revenue created by this spices trade. And we have to think another thing also, all the foreign travelers like Ibn Battuta or the traveler like Abdul Razak, they point out that they are honest. Zamorin as an honest one. That is why it is called, Calicut is called the city of truth. So he is very honest, and in stories, Keralaulpathi and other stories, he is highlighted as an honest ruler. So at least for the traders, he is honest. And Ibn Battuta says that in all other ports, what happens is that when a ship is wrecked, the materials will be taken as a windfall gained by the rulers. But in Calicut, that will be given to the same person, the ship owner. That's a great thing according to Ibn Battuta, which Abdul Razak also says. Only the 1/8/16th of the merchandise brought in the wreckage will be taken by the ruler. The remaining will be given back to the owner. It's a wonderful one, and that honesty of the ruler, they all appreciate. We have so many stories in the Keralaulpathi tradition as well. So with Arabs, actually, they maintained a good rapport, which we can see when the Portuguese came to Calicut. That's why Portuguese could not settle in Calicut, and they have to search for other places like Kannur, Cochin, or Goa. So we'll move to other structures as well.
Yeah, talking about the generosity of Zamorin to his traders, there's another story about a structure called Ambarasan Kettu. A shipwrecked trader was allowed to actually keep his merchandise inside a granite cellar, which was built exclusively for that purpose. And it was kept safe for him till the time he came back for the next voyage. So that is the kind of the reputation that the Zamorin enjoyed as a promoter of trade. No wonder he became a very, very flourishing king. We also briefly mentioned about the Shahbandar Koya. The Shahbandar Koya was actually an Arab, and he was the harbor master. Now, to support the port, he also laid out warehouses. And those warehouses structures are very, very interesting. You know, they've got open yards where these spices could be dried. They've got sheds in which they could be stored. Then there are residences in the same complex, in the same building, for people who work there. And the sea-facing first floor of the building is for the chief merchant. So he could really keep a watch as to when the ships are coming. He could also look inside and see what is happening to his commodity. So everything that protected trade, that allowed trade to flourish. He also had a marketplace. The famous marketplace of Calicut called the Valiyangadi, where even today, everything from spices to fireworks are available. You know, the first gun shop set up in Calicut or anywhere in Kerala, that shop has still got a license of 1841 or 1842. So it had everything from, you know, spices to gunpowder. Interestingly, as I'm researching for a book of local history of this area where I'm staying in Bombay, I find that in the 1600s, the first purchase of gunpowder by the British East India Company was made from the Zamorin. So now, following the arrival of Gama, the European powers start coming. Till now, we talked about the Arabs. The European powers start coming. And Zamorin actually allots all of them also trade posts. Calicut has still got a very well demarcated French trade post. It's got a very well demarcated Dutch trade post. Those of you who are from Calicut should know that, you know, the All India Radio station and the corporation building, they exist in the French log, the French territory, the French trade post. And the beach hospital next door exists in the Dutch trade post. But the Portuguese were the first ones to come. And they had problems. You know, they actually were allowed to even set up a fort. But they had problems. And that is why, you know, they had to leave Calicut. And or probably they were even chased away. So I would request Dr. Haridas to quickly tell us about the problems. Why did the problems come? And why, how were they chased away, the Portuguese?
Yes. The only problem the Zamorin had with the traders, the foreign traders, is that he will not give anybody a monopoly in trade. He will allow all the traders, all the foreign traders, to have a free trade in Calicut. But the Portuguese doesn't want a free trade because they could not compete with the Arabs, those who already established trade for so many centuries. So they want their own monopoly in the spice trade, which Zamorin did not allow. That's why the struggle between the Portuguese and Zamorin started. And Zamorin never considered their claim of monopoly, but he always allowed them to purchase spices from the open market. They can purchase spices from Calicut town, Calicut port, and they can have their own warehouses. They can build their own warehouses. That's allowed. But actually what happened was they always tried against the Arabs. So they already had a competition, a rivalry against the Arabs. The European Arab rivalry is there. So because of that, they always disbelieved this group of people called Arabs. And they want the Arabs to be avoided from the trading scenario. That's why it became a problematic. Even then, Zamorin allowed, as you mentioned rightly, the fort was built. Portuguese fort was built within Calicut. Even Arabs were not interested of their presence. Zamorin allowed them to have their own fort and their own warehouses. But later, the events turned in a violent way, they have to flee from Calicut. That is what happened. And we have the French people, Dutch, as well as English. As you mentioned, English, they had a cordial relation with English from early period onwards. The English merchants, I had a reference in a palace chronicle that English merchants are giving him presents when other chettis, the Coromandel Coast traders, are giving. Along with that, these English merchants also giving presents to the Zamorin. So, like that, Zamorin always patronized or supported the foreign traders, of even if it is Dutch, French, or Portuguese, or English. He allowed them to have a free trade there, but never allowed them to have a monopolistic trade, which the European powers always tried for.
Yeah, so now, it is, so now we've had the Arabs, the Chinese, the European powers, and into this space came numerous Indian trading communities, the Gujaratis, the Kutchis, the Parsis, the Sindhis, the Andhraites, the Tamilians. Numerous Indian trading cities came, and they've all made their mark on the city. And most interestingly, many of these communities made Calicut their home. And we have a Gujarati street, we have a Parsi Anjuman, we have a Kachi community in Calicut, we have a Jain community in Calicut, we have a Sindhi Darbar in Calicut, we even have a Syrian Christian community in Calicut, we have a Tamil community, we have an Andhraite community. So all the various Indian trading communities came and made Calicut a boiling pot of trading communities. We saw the problems with the Portuguese, and it is thanks to these problems with the Portuguese that the Marakkars emerged. For 100 years, four generations of the Marakkars fought valiantly for the Zamorins and chased away the Portuguese from the waterfront of Calicut. That's another glorious chapter in Calicut's history, the Marakkars of Calicut. Now, it is because of certain Brahminical restrictions that the Hindus were not allowed to go to sea. And that's why the Zamorin even passed a diktat that communities along the coast that wish to go to sea can even convert to Islam so that, you know, they can go to, they can take to the waters. Given that, we will now go away a little from the sea and come to the eastern side of the royal palace and the royal fort, because it was in the safety of the eastern side that all his officials stayed. For example, the Mangatachan, who was his prime minister, stayed very close to the Mananjara, where, you know, the police office and all is there today. The BEM school is there today. There is an abandoned piece of land. That is where the Mangatachan's palace was. And then further east was the Karyakar Kunda, where all the high officials stayed. I would request Karyakars, and also about the Kudravattath Nayar. You know, Calicut has got a place called Kudravattam, which was actually his stable. And the Kudravattath Nayar was his cavalry chief. So I would, you know, because we are already at 8:52, I think in the next 2-3 minutes, you could briefly talk about the Karyakars and the Kudravattath Nayar, Dr. Haridas.
Yes. Karyakar is actually ministers under Zamorin. Mangatachan, as you mentioned, is the prime minister, Sarvadi Karyakar. And there are other Karyakar like Paranambi, Thinenjeri Ilayadu, and Dharmothu Panikkar. And still other Karyakars like Tharakkal Variyar acted as Karyakar. Then they are appointed shortly, like Vallabhatta Kunnikurikkal. Actually, he is a marshal, that is Kalari chief, Vallabhatta. Like that, so many Karyakars, they functioned as ministers under Zamorin, stayed along with the palace complex or near to the palace complex. And that's why it's called, as you mentioned, Karyakar Kun. And the entire other residences of other functionaries, minor functionaries, Pultis, Adhikaris, and other officials near to these palace complex and the streets. Now we have not much time to elaborate, but streets like Chinese Street or the Silk Street, the Flower Streets is there. The various streets are there, and those streets actually were outside the fort complex, which later came into, as you mentioned, SM Street and all came into the main fortress complex in the British or the colonial period. So this is how Zamorin designed this city with all the necessary royal functionaries, necessary artisans, necessary traders. In and around the city, he built a wonderful city, which became one of the important cities in medieval world.
Briefly talk about the Kudravattath Nayar in a minute or so.
Yes. Kudravattath, the tradition says that he is the son of the Zamorin. He marries Nithyar and he will have progenies in this relationship. Kudravattath Nayar is given, the Veera Sringala is given to Kudravattath Nayar by Zamorin himself. And he is one of the prominent lord or the Naduwari under Zamorin. He is given sword and the robe, Walum Pudavayum was given. And he in return gives 3,000 panams. It's a huge amount. One of the prominent chief under Zamorin is this Kudravattath Nayar. At present, we have Kudravattam, the place called Kudravattam, from this vestige of the Kudravattath Nayar.
Yeah, so it was actually the anklet of valor that was presented by the Zamorin to this Kudravattath Nayar. Incidentally, if you see the earliest portraits of the Zamorin, you will see two anklets of valor, one on either of his ankles. But in the later pictures, you will see only one of them. That is because he gifted the other one to the Kudravattath Nayar. As Dr. Haridas said, there were numerous streets outside the palace, outside the fort to support the city. There was a weaver street, you know, there was a coppersmith street, there was a goldsmith street, all kinds of communities. And, you know, there were also temples for the Zamorin to pray and for the others to pray. For example, the Chaliyatheru, the weaver street had a Ganpati temple. The Zamorin himself had the Valayanad temple, the Devi temple, the Varakal temple, and of course the Thali temple itself. So this was a city which was very well laid out to be administered and to be utilized as a maritime trade center. Now, it is to this city, due to certain problems that were created by the Zamorin himself, that Hyder Ali comes and compels the Zamorin to actually blow up that majestic fort. And that officially ends the era of the Zamorins. And later, you know, Tipu, the successor of Hyder Ali, gets defeated by the British. And the British now take control of Calicut, giving the Zamorin just a titular role, which still continues. Now, because of this beautiful planning of the city and, you know, this splendid and deep and detailed history that is available, caricatured by people starting from Ibn Battuta right up to Dr. Haridas, we have beautiful heritage trails in Calicut. Very, very well laid out thematic heritage trails. And that's what I have tried to discover by way of a royal trail, a harbor trail, a Kutijura trail, or a sweetmeat trail, or even a canal-bound trail, because later when the British came, they made the Canoli Canal to connect up that well-known waterway which stretches from the north to south of Kerala. So there can be a canal-bound trail. So all kinds of heritage trails are available. And while we may not have much of the Zamorin's symbols to showcase the heritage, there are a lot of symbols which are available, set up by, for example, the Basel Mission, which had a large, huge presence in Calicut. The British, the Dutch, the Portuguese, the Arabs, and the local Indian communities, as I said, like the Gujaratis, Parsis, Kachis, Memans, Andhraites, they've all left their marks on the city. And therefore, Calicut, thanks to this very well-planned cityscape and very well laid out streets and lanes and by lanes, is actually a heaven for a heritage enthusiast. And Calicut, as I have always said, has the potential to become the heritage capital of Kerala. And, you know, sadly, that one prominent structure right in the heart of the Calicut city, which is the Comtrust building, which was actually a weaving mill set up by the Basel Mission, which used to supply fabric all over the world, including the fireproof silk fabric of Air India's, aircraft when the Maharaja ruled the skies, and the Buckingham Palace. Now, that building, unfortunately, is now neglected and going into ruin and collapse. If we are able to resurrect at least the main office of the Comtrust building and make that as a hub of Calicut's heritage, Calicut has the potential to become the heritage capital of Kerala. And the good thing is that the district administration, along with the political leadership of Calicut and the community leaders of Calicut and the tourism department, have started some ventures. For example, the beach has now got a Freedom Square. The architects of Calicut are playing a wonderful role. I really, really appreciate the architects of Calicut for this. They have set up a Freedom Square. They've now beautified the beach. They are doing the Kutichira area. They have done the Thali area with plaques announcing this heritage. Incidentally, while I was in Calicut, every month there is to be 20 American senior citizens walking, these heritage trails of Calicut with me. So you actually got a treasure trove there, and it is for the powers that be of Kerala's tourism to listen to this, the inner voice of Calicut's heritage and Calicut's history, and establish it as the heritage capital of Calicut. With this, both of us, Dr. Haridas and I, we thank you all. I'm sure, I don't know if there are questions. We will take on questions if you've got the time.
I also didn't see any question here.
Yeah, there was a question. What is the reason why not much of the heritage buildings of Zamorin not preserved for people now? Most of the buildings today are used for... Yeah, as I said, the Zamorin actually blew up his fort. There are buildings of the Zamorin. For example, the temples are still there. There is the Tiruvachira palace complex, which is which actually was a place where all the palm leaf records were preserved. That is still there. There are some remnants of of the Ambadi Kovilagam, for example, or there is the Swargamadam, the hillock from where the Tali, the Brahmins who fought the Samudri, seem to have gone to heaven. So some of these things are there. The temples are there, as I said. But because the Zamorin blew himself up and his fort up, he destroyed the epicenter of his heritage. And, then there was a reign of Tipu. Then there was Hyder Ali. And then the British came in. And Zamorin really, really got marginalized to such an extent that, that gold chain that the Zamorin used to wear as a gold, as a symbol of his royalty, over the generations has reduced in size. Now, nobody knows where is the rest of the gold chain going. And I sometimes hear, this grand old men who are now the Zamorins of Calicut complaining that they've really lost a lot of their royalty and their heritage. But yeah, we can at least rediscover. And it's the beauty of this royal trail for me was that I was rediscovering a city in the middle of a teeming township with absolutely nothing. So that, that is a big challenge and that's a big excitement. So those who want to trace the, the heritage of Calicut have this stimulating challenge to recreate 800 years of history in the middle of, shops and establishments. Dr. Haridas, if you wish to add anything.
Yeah. Only a few visible things are there, like Mananjira, which is actually this now act as the center of the city with other palaces like Tiruvachira, Mangavu. We have other temples. Actually, in fact, we have temples, but we have so many names like Silk Street, SM Street, all these street, Gujarati street, all these street itself shows the heritage of Calicut, which actually we can make as the center of our heritage tourism. Now, if
there's one. Oh, this is Commander Mohan Narayan. I'm very certain this is Commander Mohan Narayan. He is an authority on Bombay's history. He was actually the curator of the Maritime History Society. So I also commemorate their voyages. The Chinese built a stele at Calicut, any reference in local records. Dr. Haridas, we have tried to locate it, but it's gone missing.
Actually, we have only that reference in the Chinese records of Mahuan, where he says about this. And actually, from Anuradhapuram, they found out it. In Sri Lanka also, he mentions like the such a monument, which actually later found out. So there is all the chance of such a monument, but unfortunately, we doesn't have any evidence for such thing, and then there is no reference to this because it is a 15th century monument. So actually, the documents are speaking about 16th and 17th century only, and we have no reference about it. And incidentally, we don't have much of the early monuments. Only one slab is found. When digging was done, a slab of maybe palace or the temple was found from the Calicut city, which is now kept in the museum, Parshiraja Museum at the East Hill. So like that, we don't have much evidences, and local records, of course, not mentioning anything about it. Actually, the earlier scholars under Nobuharu Karashima searched for this. Hariprasad Ray came and he also searched for this, but that was in the 90s and 2000s, but they could not find any evidence of such a monument, and it may be lost in the middle, or maybe be optimistic. We may, in the next years, we may somehow find out the monument.
This stone slab that Dr. Haridas was mentioning is kept on the gateway at the entrance of the children's park of the Parshiraja Museum. Yes. I would request you all to actually write something about it, because right now there's nothing written about it. So that I would request you all to write something. Incidentally, you know, there are a lot of churches which we just forgot, because we briefly mentioned the Europeans. They have left a lot of churches behind. They have left certain other structures behind. And if you see the architecture, for example, the English Palli is a typical English church, actually an English chapel. Or if you look at the Mother of God Church, it's still got a lot of Portuguese architect style in it. Now, also the Chinese team that came to look for that plaque, which Commander Monaran is talking about, I think they chanced upon certain coins in the university, isn't it, sir? Dr. Haridas, I think they came across some Chinese coins in the university.
Chinese coins and porcelain, certain porcelain, yes. Also portraits they found out under Nobuharu Karashima, actually. And there is an article on this Chinese remains by Raghav Arir. M.R. Raghav Arir wrote The Chinese Contact in Calicut. He traced that. Actually, he was one of the experts in that Chinese exploration in Calicut. They also published, a report was published actually in the Japanese series. They published a report. But beyond that, we don't have much local evidences on Chinese.
Yeah, we should also mention local historians of Calicut. Calicut is probably the best living historian in India today. Dr. M.G.S. Narayanan, then Dr. Raghav Arir. Dr. Panikkar. So these are all very, very strong historians who've taken the trouble to chronicle a lot of Calicut's history. Calicut has got a Calicut Heritage Society. It's got a fairly strong intact movement. It's got some qualified, very good guides in Calicut. So Calicut has all the potential to develop into a heritage capital. Request if Mr. Menon has asked, request if these palaces or Kovilakams can be situated with modern references to places in modern day Calicut city. Yes, actually we can, you know, the physical location, if you look at the revenue records of Calicut, for example, there is a tall building called Zamorina, which stands right next to the Thali tank. That compound is called the Puthan Kovilakam Paramba. So the revenue records say that this was the Pudhya Kovilakam compound, and just next to that, there was actually a big gateway for, you know, that lady who stayed in the Pudhya Kovilakam to come down into the tank and have a bath. The Kelke Kovilakam is also marked in the revenue records. So is Ambadi Kovilakam. Ambadi Kovilakam is still there in the revenue records. So these references are there in the revenue records. So if you really superimpose it on a map, you can re-establish, you know, the locations of these palaces and Kovilakams. However, to recreate them is not possible, because now they've got the property is used for numerous other purposes. Dr. Haridas, if you wish to say anything.
Yes, because the places are already converted as a city lines, and we could not recreate the palaces, but we have the, as you mentioned, the revenue documents, settlement documents mention all the places, and I think Dr. N. N. Nambudiri has placed these in the map of Calicut. Yes. Actually, he beautifully done a work, a PhD work on these places, and he has made this study, a wonderful study, where he actually places all the palaces, forts, temples in the Calicut city.
Yeah, now, it may not be really possible to recreate these structures. However, if the residents or the other users of the property allow, I'm sure you can possession plaques there to announce that, yeah, this was one of the royal residences. So these kind of plaques can be set up. The big advantage that I'm sure the DTPC people, the tourism people and the district administration shall take note of this. There is a stone lying near the, you know, that Palayam subway. I have requested Nirmati to actually resurrect that stone. It could be one of the stones used in the palace complex. The great advantage Calicut today has, that Kerala's cultural minister and Kerala's tourism minister are both from Calicut. I think that's a very potent combination to resurrect Calicut's history and market it, brand it as the heritage capital of Kerala. Tourists who are going to Wayanad, tourists who are going to other places have found Calicut as an interesting stopover. And they are more than interested to, revisit the history and heritage of Calicut. I wish, the tourism minister and the cultural minister take note of this and really, really give Calicut its due. Yeah, I can see Comrade Samir Agarwal. Could you elaborate on the Brahminical diktat of preventing anybody going to see? I would not like to get into the politics of it. However, the Brahmins had, given a diktat that if you go to Paradesh or you go sail into
cross the sea.
If you cross the sea, you would get polluted. And it was so, so vehemently followed that a poet and an English professor, a celebrated poet and an English professor of Kerala University, Dr. Vishnarayana Nambudiri, who after giving up his professorship, went back into his family temple as a priest. And somewhere somebody found out that during his tenure in the university, he had traveled abroad for some academic program. And they coaxed him out of the temple. Now, that was a kind of diktat. Samir, I'm sure you can call me up and I'll tell you more about it. There were political reasons. They wanted to probably have us a Kob Mandoks, frogs in the well, did not want us to discover the world. But you are lucky. You are a naval officer. So as many of us who are, our generation is very lucky. Today, the same Brahmins are sitting in Silicon Valley and all over the place. So I think, they've broken away from that. But this was historically one of the constraints that was imposed. Dr. Haridas, if you wish to say anything.
Yes. we need not to move on to the medieval politics because the Varna ideology was like that. It always put some restriction on people. It always prevented people to have a public space. It prevented people to travel. All these are there. And we could not or we cannot deny such things. But the thing is that the Arabs, then the Muslims of Calicut were the traders, and they actually done all the work for the Zamorin, and they acted as the naval force for the Zamorin. As you mentioned, Kunjali Marakas is they were the admirals of Zamorin for so many years.
Yeah, actually, since Dr. Haridas mentioned about the naval part of it, I'm sure a lot of naval officers are listening to this. The Naval Academy, the mothership of the Naval Academy is INS Zamorin. It's named after the family, the royal family. And the royal family has gifted, the trophy for the best all-round passing out lady officer of the Naval Academy. So that shows their matriarchal, lineage. And my only urge is that the Naval Academy, because of its proximity to Calicut, should maintain a very, very close link with the city. The Kunjali Marakas residence in Iringal is looked after by the Naval Academy. Earlier, they used to every year go there and have a parade there. Commander Mohan Narayan has come and gone there and even urged the Naval Academy to continue that. We used to, for a couple of years, have the Naval Band play in Calicut. So these traditions should continue so that the naval heritage of Calicut is proclaimed and maintained by the naval community, the present day naval community, and the Naval Academy can play a very proactive role in this.
Right. So I think now we can wind up.
Yes, I think we should both do a namaste and wind up. So thank you, Dr. Haridas. Thank you, Kerala Literature Fest, Kerala Architecture Fest, DC Books, and all the patrons for giving us this wonderful opportunity. So together, let us build the Calicut as the heritage capital of Kerala. Thank you very much. Jai Hind.
Thank you. Yeah. Thank you. Yeah.